Good morning, everybody. First of all, I want to say that I'm really happy and I think really lucky to participate to the CRI conference. It's the first time for me, and I'm very happy to be there with you. So we will speak about the duration of QT interval in athletic individuals. So the learning objectives will be to see the physiology and pathophysiology of interval QT durations, measurement and analysis of QT interval duration on UCG, diagnosis of long and short QT syndromes, diagnosis of abnormal QT interval durations in athletes, and current recommendations for sport participation in case of QT duration abnormality. First, what is the electrophysiological significance of QT duration? You see here the normal action potential with the movement of ions, and here you have the representations of the action potential on the UCG. So the QT duration represents the beginning of the depolarization of the first ventricular cell until the end of the repolarization of the last ventricular cell. And now when we look to the gene that codes for channels, you see that we can have mutation, for example, the mutation on potassium ionic channel, and you see that you have an increase of action potential of duration, and you can see that the QT duration is increased, and you have a risk of arrhythmias if the QT duration is too long, or on the other side, when the QT duration is too short. So we know that the abnormal QT interval durations is due to mutation in genes coding for mainly delayed rectifier potassium or sodium channels. However, we must keep in mind that you can have a prolongation of QT durations in case of hypokalemia or hypocalcemia and in case of use of some drugs. We have a lot of mutations of genes which concern here long QT duration or here short QT durations. However, in more than 70% of cases, the long QT durations are due to three mutations, long QT1, long QT2, and long QT3. Why are we interested for long QT durations and exercise, QT duration and sports? Because we know that exercise can be a trigger for sudden death in a relation with the gene mutation. For example, you see here that in long QT1, most of sudden death or most of syncope arrived during exercise, during intense exercise. However, in long QT3 or in long QT2, you see that it is not the same trigger. The trigger is mostly emotion or sleep in long QT3 syndrome. So why exercise can induce arrhythmia? You see here the evolution, the normal evolution of QTC duration, QT duration during exercise. Here is the rest period, exercise period, and then the recovery period. And you see that in control, you have an increase of during the increase of heart rate, you see that QT duration is decreasing, and then after, during recovery, it goes back. And now if you see in long QT syndrome, you have an abnormal increase of QT durations during exercise and during recovery. So during exercise, you can have, in case of long QT syndrome, an increase of QT duration with an increased risk of arrhythmias. So the first question I want to ask to you is concern the parameters that depend on individual QT interval durations. So the first question is, do you think that heart rate, gender, drugs, age, or training and training level can increase the interval QT durations? So when we look to these five propositions, you see that all are right, except for the height. Heart rate, gender, drugs, and training level can increase QT durations. For example, we know that heart rate increase the QT duration, and it is why we must correct QT duration, absolute QT durations, by heart rate. And it's not so easy because you see here that we have a lot of formula to correct QT duration. And if we have a lot of QT formula, it means that no formula is really good. So the most used formula is the Bazet formula. Bazet formula correct absolute QT durations by the square root of the RR durations before the QT durations you measure. Gender, we know that in females, QT duration is longer than in males. And age, we know that in young people, very young people, QT duration may be longer. So, how to measure QT durations? First, we must remember that you have an UCG of abnormal QT duration. You have not only an abnormal duration of QT, but also in many times you can have abnormal T-wave patterns. And you see, for example, in long QT1 syndrome, that the T-wave pattern is not really normal. It is a very long increase of QT. Here, in long QT2, you have a bifid T-wave. In long QT3, you have a symmetric T-wave, a very long time after the end of QRS. And in LQT4, for example, you have a positive then and negative T-wave pattern. It's the same in short QT syndrome. You see that in QT syndrome, you have a very acute T-wave pattern and a very very large T-wave pattern here. So we must look to the T-wave pattern and then we must measure the QT duration. How to measure the QT duration? Of course, we have, when we perform UCG, we have an automatic measurement of QT duration. However, we know that we can have a difference between the manual measurement and the automatic measurement. So I think in case of doubt, you must use the tangent method to measure manually the QT durations. So here you have the beginning of QRS complex, the end of T-waves. You put the tangent of the T-wave here, and the QT interval is here. You do not include U-wave in the measurement, and it's better to do the measurement in LID2 or V5. And as I said before, when you use the Bazet formula, you must make the ratio between QT interval, absolute QT interval here, and the square root of the RR duration before the QT you want to measure. When you make this measurement, it's not so easy to say that QT duration is too long, because as you see on this slide, you have an overlap zone between subject with genetic abnormalities concerning gene coding for QT durations and normal population. So there is not a clear cutoff of value of QT duration. However, it has been proposed that in general population, in males, QT, corrected QT must be less than 450 milliseconds, and in female, 460 milliseconds. As we saw before, we know that drugs can affect QT interval durations, and you see that there is a lot of drugs. So in case of patients with long QT syndrome, you must not use these drugs because your risk of increase the duration of action potential and to increase the QT interval duration. Diagnosis long QT syndrome is really a challenge, and you see that there is a score proposed by Schwartz and Ackermann, and this score, you see the duration of QT interval. However, you have also the duration of QT, corrected QT durations during the recovery after exercise, arrhythmias, and other abnormalities of T-waves. You have also clinical history and family history. When you are low or when you have a value of score under or one, it's the low risk of the risk of QT syndrome, long QT syndrome is low. Between 1.5 to 3.5, it is intermediate, and it is high when you are higher than 3.5. It's the same for short QT syndrome. You have some score, and the score of proposed firstly by Bob Golob has been recently modified. However, you see, concerning the value, that the lower value of QT duration is between 330 to 370, and you can propose a risk of short QT syndromes in front of these values. So, second question concerning the QT duration in athletes. Upper limit of QT durations is the same in athletes than in general population. Is there any specific gene mutations involved in long QT syndromes? Most competitive sport participations are forbidden for a subject presenting with long QT syndrome type 1. Concerning diagnosis of long QT syndromes, exercise test is not helpful. And concerning diagnosis of long QT syndrome, echocardiography is helpful. Only one proposition is true. The proposition true is that most competitive sport participations are currently forbidden for a subject presenting with long QT type 1. So we will see the other propositions later on. First, we had the possibility in our team to study a lot of athletes and the QT durations. The first question was, is QT duration increased in athletes? It concerns about more than 300 athletes and 300 controls. And you will see that, yes, here in red is controls, in blue is athletes. Yes, the QT duration is increased in athletes. In males, the upper limit proposed is 470 milliseconds, and in females, 480 milliseconds. Second question, how can we explain that QT duration is increased in athletes? First, we know that there is an autonomic balance alteration with physical training. You have an increase of the response to parasympathetic tone, a decrease to the response of sinus node to sympathetic tone, and we have also direct intrinsic alteration. If we look to an experimental model, here it's rat, you see that the potential action of trained rat is different than from sedentary. So you have intrinsic modification of ionic channels, and it's proved here. You can see that you look to the channel I2, you have a modification between sedentary and trained, and you have modification of density and also of activity of the channels. This channel is involved in the repolarization duration, so we can explain why there is an increase of QT duration in athletes. Is there an ethnicity effect on QT duration in athletes? We know that we can observe several specific patterns of T waves in Afro-Caribbean athletes. We had the opportunity to collaborate with Sanjay Sharma groups on this point. So we look to the QTC durations, and we compare QTC duration in Africans, in Caucasian, in Japanese, and in North Africans. And you see that we do not observe significant modification of durations in athletes in correspondence with ethnicity. And lastly, is there any sport specificity effect on QT durations? We compare endurance, powered, and mixed athlete, and we do not observe significant difference of QT duration concerning the sports practiced. Another very important point concerning the measurement of QT duration in athletes concerns the formula of Bazet, because Bazet, in his paper, said that his formula is good for an heart rate between 55-60 beats per minute until 80 and 19 beats per minute. However, in athletes, we know that we have a lot of people with bradycardia. And we compare the slopes of relation between QT durations and RR durations in athletes with a heart rate lower than 50 beats per minute and athletes with an heart rate higher than 50 beats per minute. And you see that we do not have the same slope when you have a low heart rate when you have a low heart rate than when you have a high heart rate. And when we look to the corrections due to Bazet formula, you see that when you have an athlete with bradycardia, QT duration is underestimated with this formula. So now, concerning the sport participation in case of QT syndromes, who play and who sit. When we look to the USA recommendations, we see that the European Society of Cardiology recommendation used the same upper limit values than for general populations. And in case of long QT syndrome, you cannot allow competitive sports even if you have a genotype positive and a phenotype negative subject. No competitive, no intensive leisure time sports activity. When we look to the Bethesda recommendation that have been published in 2005, like the recommendation from the European Society of Cardiology, you see that your American people propose to use longer QT duration, as we saw before, and they accept competitive sports in the classification of Mitchell 1A. It concerns billiard, bowling, cricket, riflery, and golf, except for long QT syndrome type 3. And in case of positive genotype and negative phenotypes, there is no contraindication for sports, and no swim. In any case, you cannot allow swimming for long QT 1 syndrome. Concerning short QT syndrome, it's more easier, no competitive, no intensive sport activity can be allowed in subjects with short QT syndromes, both for European and American recommendation. However, as Sanjay said in the introduction, we know that physical activity is good for health, so it must be recommended to participate to physical activity, even in subjects to QT syndromes. However, we must recommend only sport with low or moderate intensity and a stable intensity during all the session of training. We must avoid low, fast, low activity, and I mean, for example, most of team sports, long duration activity, hot or cold conditions, and we must avoid the sport with risk of, in case of syncope, like climbing, for example. We must, in all cases, respect the treatment and a good hydration with electrolyte. So, how to confirm long QT syndrome in athletes? We have several propositions. First, we must make manual confirmation of QT durations. We must do standing UCG recordings. We must repeat UCG recording in case of a slight increase of long QT durations. We must look to familial and personal history about sudden death syncope. We must perform patient's first relative UCG because sometimes you can observe a long QT syndrome in the mother or in the father, so the diagnosis is confirmed. We must perform maximal exercise with abrupt passive recovery, Holter recording. We are not used in our institute with epinephrine test, but we know that it is used in other institutions in France. What about day training? We will see one case. And lastly, genetic test. Here is an example of a cyclist, asymptomatic cyclist, young cyclist. And you see the UCG in supine position. There is a long QT duration. However, if you do UCG in standing positions, you see that there is a very, very long increasing of the QT duration after 1 minute after the subject is stand up. So it's really easy to see that there is a not normal dynamic adaptation. Why exercise testing for identifying? You see here that you have in long QT syndrome carriers an increase of collected QT during in comparison with control in supine position, standing position, but also during exercise and during the recovery. And the best is to measure QT duration 4 minutes at the 4th minute of the recovery period. And lastly, here is a swimmer, asymptomatic, no family history. You see the QT, collected QT duration more than 500 milliseconds during training, 16 hours per week. He stopped training during 4 months, and you see that his collected QT is now 440 milliseconds. So it's not so easy to be sure that you have an abnormal QT duration. However, to my opinion, but it's only to my opinion, it's not physiological to have an increase of QT duration from 440 to 520 after a long period of training. So the take-home message, in athletes, the QT corrected QT upper limits of 470 milliseconds in males and 480 milliseconds in females seems more adapted to provide additional diagnosis tests. Current recommendations are very restrictive for competitive sports in case of QT syndrome. And for borderline QT duration, several diagnosis criteria must be used and before to exclude an athlete for competitive sport. Thank you very much for your attention.